Now, let me know if this particular screen the text is too small to view for the future. I can zoom in a little bit closer, but I'll start to lose detail if I get too close to the text. Okay. So I'll reiterate what I was mentioning to Frederica officially for the presentation. Today's presentation is Chapter 6, Functions, but we've already covered the chapter from last week's video. Frederica presented that particular media. Towards the end of that chapter, one of the topics was, as a group, go back and do a little bit of homework and provide some more context or more input to this particular functions chapter. And its importance is as we get into Chapter 7 environments or into, I think it's Chapters 13 and 14, which are S3 and S4 objects, that this functions chapter is kind of critical in a formal association to those future topics. Okay, so I highlighted and I wanted to extract the one comment from John Chambers, author of the S language and co-author of the S language, and then his association to the R foundation in general, R base. There's another word for it, but it's the team that formed the R association and then the language that generated past that. And that has a critical moment with the relationship of the S3, S4 concept. And I'll kind of expand on that here briefly. But what the quote in our text, Chapter 6, says, everything that exists is an object. Everything that is in R is an object. And that anything that is an object, everything that happens would be a function call. So any manipulation, any change, any modification to those objects is going to be done through some level of functioning, some level of object-oriented programming with this function call. Now, expanding into that subject, the intent or what I was trying to convey within this context was the first bullet is easy to comprehend. That's pretty simple, right? If we just remember that everything is an object, then it's going to have some kind of a naming convention to it. Whether it's hidden or not, we would be able to access it, view it, and manipulate it. Okay, so just know that the object is critical. The second bullet, though, is a little bit more ephemeral. It's a little bit more difficult because there's a huge quantity of how an operating system or how our computing program works in association to management or manipulation of those variables. So the second bullet is where my quest resides. I want to define the workflow or commands to step through or trace the relationship of an object and depict the association to each level of the stack. And the word stack in my definition here is the entire R program in general. So these different various storage mechanisms or manipulation mechanisms that are used within R. So what I did or I tried to do, and this is a multitude of different reading points that I've compiled, is I started to draw out a diagram. Please be willing to critique my association of how this diagram is authored. I'm in no way, shape, or form conveying that this is accurate. In fact, I'm pretty sure that I've made some critical mistakes, but I'm hoping the feedback from the group may be able to reassociate some of this. What I wanted to call out is this thought process of namespace. Now, in our current advanced R chapters, we haven't really covered what namespace is. We make relation to it. We discuss what it, we use the name, but we don't really know what namespace is. So I wanted to define kind of this object of what namespace. It is the path to libraries. It's the path to storage. It's the path to where we're working within. And we can have multiple namespaces. So easily accessible is you can do a load namespaces, and it'll provide all the packages and libraries that you currently have engaged in your search window or in, search feature or within the loaded environment of an existing program. So I'm going to pause for a second and show you what I'm referring to. Let me go over to R real quick. Now, I've completely started from fresh because I didn't want any past history to corrupt anything that I was doing. So I'm just going to run that load namespaces, loaded namespace argument. Okay. And what we see, again, this is just me opening up R. I have not done any sort of library calls or associations to packages. This is just kind of what base namespaces are available to me. So we have the McGritter, use this, DevTools, GR devices, package load, R6, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. What is more specific that I want to highlight is base. There it is right there. Okay. So by default, the base programming language, and in my association to that comment would be the S language, is already built into R. So I'm already accessing, just by opening the program, I already have access to all of these various functions and et cetera. Okay. The second thing that I wanted to do, let me go back to Chrome here, is then talk about the environment itself. Now, you can have multiple environments. And in chapter 6, we were making associations to this classification or class of type that is metadata attached to objects that we create. Functions would be an object. But we manipulate those functions inside their curly brackets, give some kind of a logic change, and then expect an output on how that would manipulate our current environment, right? Well, we can have multiple environments. That's the trick here. So the R environment, the global environment is kind of like your, what's the word I'm thinking of? It's like the shell window, but I know that that's not appropriate how I'm conveying it. I want it to be this kind of open canvas of nothing's there yet. I just have this ability to access all of these functions. Nothing's really set up yet. With this global environment, as we start to add packages or include packages into our namespace, it now gives more access to those functions within those various packages. That gets us into this dispatching concept. Now, the dispatch is not going to be opened up as a topic until we get into chapter 13, I believe. So I'm kind of future-proofing the topics of what we're going to be covering in the coming weeks. This dispatch is part or a child of, it's not really the global environment, it creates its own environment on its own. And inside the dispatch scoping concept is our function that we create, or a function within a package. Now, what needs to be very clearly defined is the separation between an S3 object and an S4 object. Now, S3 would be our more classic S language thought process, whereas S4 is the future of the R language itself. And the reason this is for me personally, and I'm pointing at myself as being the topic here, because this is confusing, is I've got a legacy application of object-oriented programming, and I have this more future concept of object-oriented programming. And this happened between John Chambers authoring the S language, and then as it gets passed over to the R group, and then we create this new concept of this R language instead. Okay. So S3 is more classic, whereas S4 is more advanced, we'll call it. It has different ways of manipulation, but I would say that it's more of like a technology concept, right? Like, we didn't have the ability to do what we do in S4 in that day. Okay. Sorry, real quick. All right, so what I wanted to pull up is this search feature. And this is where things start to get really cool, is now if I call on search, this is all of my loaded namespace. That's just me opening the program, my empty canvas that I'm referring to. Now I can search, and that will give me all of my current environments or the ability of accessing these certain applications, these packages. And again, going back to my graphic of the functions being association to the S3, S4, I don't want to use method class, it's the environment of this S3, S4 thought process, which function call is going to be assigned. And the first attribute of that function is going to be how it associates. So if we have a data frame, if we have a numeric value, if we have an integer, excuse me, a character, it changes which class is called on. Let me double check that statement, but which form of that function and how it is manipulated within that global environment. Okay. So the next thing would be, now I want to list all of the available functions within a given package. So to do that, I'm just going to use the utils as an example. So I would do list and then pack, I don't need to put it in quotes, package. And then I need the single colon because that's going to pass it into what library I'm wanting to access. So in this case, it would be utils and then run that. This is now all of the various functions that are associated to that particular package. Again, being part of the base framework or the opening. I haven't called on anything yet. I haven't loaded a package yet. These are just the core attributes. Let me rewrite this again, and let's do, for example, just use a package shiny. I already have it downloaded and installed in this operating system, this computer I'm using. So now what I'm doing by calling on this library function is loading it into that namespace, okay? So now that it's installed, now I can do a search again. And you can see that I now have shiny as an object. No, that's not there. That's not what I wanted to do. Loaded namespace. And now I should be able to see shiny. Where did that go? Sorry, I'm looking around my screen if you see it.
After process, there we go. 1, 2, 3, 4.
Yep. So now that shiny is loaded into my namespace, now I can access it. So if I wanted to see what functions were available to me within the shiny context, then I would be able to do a list package shiny, and I would get specific functions associated to that single package. And then we go into our formals, body, and environment, just as chapter 6 is presenting to us. And I'll just use an example, just say slider input. I'm grabbing this arbitrarily, so we're doing this on the fly. But if I wanted to do the body of the slider input function, here I can see exactly the text that, or the logic, the argument, arguments, the syntax that would make up the association to this particular function. So that's where my presentation stops. I don't have anything more to that. If I go back to my Chrome window here, I went through these first three steps, and then I said, this is as far as I've reviewed thus far. More steps will be required to fully exercise my intent. I know there's a 3-colon exercise that I haven't used yet. When I was watching previous videos of users doing this, I know that they were making calls within the package to see more association, and that will be required shortly. I also need to comprehend the class of objects and or the relationship of both the scoping and dynamic scoping, static scoping and dynamic scoping, and the relationship of the term methods. I do have some definitions that I'm trying to work on down here. I could probably add attributes to that as well. Arthur, if you don't mind me putting you on the spot, in chapter 3, I believe is your presentation, there was a figure that you had pulled up, and we were talking about POSIX, we were talking about numeric character, the class of a object. And you had mentioned that it's metadata. I'm wanting to incorporate that into this conversation because that's where this dispatching methodology concept comes in. Class is a, there's 4 unique attributes, we'll call them, that are associated to these S3, S4 objects, one of which is class. And that's how we know if a numeric value is passed into a function, it says, well, I have this particular call, but it may be used in some other function as well. Because of the scoping concept, it would look within this context of, do I have a package that is associated to? If not, I'm going to go back up to a higher level, this global environment, before I pass back down again. We see errors sometimes if we're manipulating media within our logic, ingesting a data frame, manipulating a tibble, blah, 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 et cetera. And when we call on something and it gives us an error, that error is usually associated because it doesn't have any association to it. It doesn't know what to do with that particular call because the namespace or the package that we've loaded into that namespace is not available. Just a thought. And again, I'm not an expert at this. I'm actually trying to logically associate in my mind how we can work within this advanced R environment and access or manipulate data beyond which is normally visible to our screen. We take it for granted when we make a function call and then magically it spits out some data. Well, how did it actually calculate that? How can I go in and see the various steps or trace exactly the workflow of that manipulation to provide that output, to provide that service? I read a whole bunch of topics on the S3, S4 methodology. I read a whole bunch of topics on just the print function as a service. There's a reference to chapter 6 where it uses the use method, or maybe that's in chapter 13, but there's a use method. And we saw that in when we called on formals, I believe. Go back to R real quick. And I think if I do formals, slider input. It's not body either. Class. Well, the class is a function. That's not answering what I wanted to do. Sometimes if you run this particular command, it'll give you three or four lines of text, and one of them is use method, and then it gives you the namespace association to where that method is called in. Maybe if I do mean, let's do. No, that's not it.
We don't see your screen.
Oh, I'm sorry. is it showing the RStudio session?
No, you're not sharing.
I can see on my end.
Frederico, what screen are you seeing? Let me stop sharing real quick and I'll reshare. I thought I was doing the...
maybe it's me. I'll change it something.
Okay. Let me see if now it refreshed for you. Okay. What I was attempting to do, let me control L. If I just type a function, and I'm using mean because it's part of the base concept. There's others that we could use. Print is another one. This use method. And you get the function call, we get the X and the dot, dot, dot. But the use method is going to be a topic that we'll convey. The use method is where we link that environment concept or the S3, S4 object deployment association. So I'll stop here and see if anybody has any comments.
One quick comment, Ryan. Could you go back and could you remind me what command you did for the LS? LS package name.
Yes, it was LS and then package. But there's only a single colon. So it's not like that package association function concept of the double colon. Here, I'm just calling on the package as a service and then whatever loaded attributes. Let me go back here real quick. Arthur, let me show you what I did. So when you do search, this is going to give me all of the installed or active packages, active services that I can access from my console. Loaded namespace is the one I was after. Namespace. So let me make sure I get ED in there. Nope. You don't like that.
Yeah, I think it's a last S shouldn't be capital, I guess.
That's right. Yep. Namespace. Thank you. Try that. No. I spelled loaded correctly.
Why doesn't write? Oh, there it is.
Yep. Yeah, the me misspelling it. It didn't populate or auto populate. What I did here, Arthur, was I'm asking the console. I'm asking the R kernel, the not environment, the program itself. I'm asking it to give me back everything that I have access to. This similar concept would be if I went to packages, but this is too focused. This window of packages only gives me what I currently have within that packages thought process. If I do loaded namespaces, I have many more options, or if I use the search command, I have many more options. So like global environment is this point up here, this global environment. Or I was trying to figure out the tools RStudio. I have reason to believe that may be where some of your shortcuts come in. So if you do, you know, control enter as a shortcut to an execute command to run a particular line of text, I believe that keyboard shortcut association is within this tools RStudio. The command from the keyboard to the CPU would be managed or associated with this tools RStudio. I don't know that for a fact, and I have no way of showing that, but I have just a kind of library ability to make that claim. Go ahead.
Well, no, go ahead, Ryan. I'll come in with my question later.
So what I wanted to show, or what I wanted to finish, is you just do package, and then as a single line of text, let's just use digest as an example. Will that work? No. Go back up here to these packages. So let's use a different one. We'll say use this. So I'm calling on the use this library. Give me all of the available functions that I could access within that particular object, the package itself. So package use this, and then no quotation marks there. I'm not asking for it as a function. I'm asking for it as a package. Then it lists out any commands that may be particularly associated with. Then that stepped into my next quest of, okay, well, this GitHub token, what is happening within that particular function?
Ryan, one quick question. Well, a question and a request. So first, the question for this list of functions available for the package. Do you happen to know, are these only the publicly available functions, or would this provide you like an index of even those private functions, even though you're not as a user able to access them? We can do this as research. I just didn't know if you happen to know the answer.
I think I know the answer. So there's a topic about generics. And if I go back to our class diagram, generics is one of the points. If it is a generic function, there's a sentence or a statement in the text where it talks about closure functions. I think that's where we start, or at least I'm starting to make an association to this relationship. If I know that the variable I'm manipulating is a data frame, the variable I'm manipulating is a integer or a numeric value. Integer doesn't exist. Numeric value. If it's a character, based on that point within the package itself is going to choose on how to manipulate that. If it doesn't exist, that's where this the first part of the function call the example that we were given in chapter six was like X assignment function, and then X comma Y, and then some curly bracket, do some manipulation in here, and then pass back X. I think within that function call, the formals, the body, and the environment of that association, those three unique points. Let me see if I can pull over chapter six. I'll just, I had it open a moment ago. This will work. And let me go back up to the top here. So make this larger. If I have assignment of value 10 to the named object X, then I create a function where I'm manipulating X as a object. Inside, I'm calling a second function where I say X plus 10. If I explicitly call that back out to the screen, I'm only processing that function. What would be passed back would be X plus 10. We're already passing it as 10, so it should report back 20. And if I run that, I believe that's what happens. This is a question, by the way. Maybe I should use that. I don't like those quiz ones are trying to show us answer a question instead of give a presentation. Control V, enter. All right. So I created an object named F02, function 02. In the lexical mindset of association, the computer itself, I now provide it a named attribute F02, and then I'm assigning that F02 object the function X and Y. Inside the curly brackets would be obviously the body of what I'm doing. So I'm adding X plus Y. If I call just F02, it should come, yeah, it should give me an error because I haven't passed anything to it yet. But if I say F0, let's do Y assignment 3, sorry, back one, there we go. So now I created a variable, a named variable Y with the value 3 as a numeric, and then said that, see, X is 4. So this should give us 7. If I do this correctly. Okay, another value of 4. So then when I say function F02 with X and Y, should that compute to 7? Yes. What we just did, walking through this steps, we created a named object in the environment of our global of Y is 3, the value of 3. We know that the value of Y, sorry, the class of Y is going to be numeric. So class Y is numeric. And if I do the same thing on X, it's going to be the number 4. We get into this lexical concept of association because it is object-oriented programming, but it enforces this class concept. If within the S3, S4 dispatching system, there is no means for us to manipulate a numeric value, then it would give me an error back. That's what this error is. Well, that error is really because I hadn't assigned it yet. So I was calling on a named variable, named object that hadn't been assigned a value yet. But the concept here is that it's going to check whether or not I can manipulate that within the current package I'm in. If I can't, then I need to go jump back out into some other higher order parent environment where it would have a package or would have a function that I could manipulate. And that's the magic, I guess, of what's happening here is this hierarchical relationship of being able to jump in and out of these different environments as I manipulate my variable. Again, going back to John Chambers' quote, saying that everything is an object, that's easy to remember. It's the second bullet that actually makes this a little bit difficult to comprehend because there's a lot of steps happening within that second bullet. How do I manipulate it? Well, I manipulate it with a function. Well, the function can be multiple things. It can live in different spaces. I'm not answering your question. It's the generic, Arthur. It's the dot generic piece of this.
Thank you, Ryan.
Yep.
Okay. So it's you, Arthur, after next?
Sure. Yeah? Sure. I've got a really quick one. Let me just share my screen. Can you see my screen okay?
Yeah.
Perfect. You know, as I was reading through the chapter on functions, I was kind of struck by this part at the very beginning that, you know, talks about how about the function components. You know, you got the formals, you got the body, and you got the environment. Kind of taking those as kind of three basic ingredients. If we put this to the side, the environment part, sort of, it struck me as like you can almost think of functions as like mathematical functions in a certain sense.
Yes,
where you know, you instead of a body, you've kind of got a formula, and if you kind of continue that comparison in the way you're thinking about functions, you know, you've got a function that's just a formula that takes inputs and produces outputs. That's what a function does. It kind of maps from one thing to the other, and you know, the thing that's true for both mathematical functions and R functions is that the values of inputs change, certainly. So our value of X will change. If X is, you know, in kind of mathematical function space, it'd be, you know, some number, set of numbers. In function space, it would be more, you know, this would be a value of one of our parameters. But what's true in mathematical functions and what seems initially to be true in R functions is that the formula is kind of immutable, right? You have a set of steps that are followed to produce reliably, consistently, always produce an output. But actually, that turns out kind of not to be the case. This I guess links to things that we'll see in the metaprogramming chapter, I think in chapter 18 or somewhere thereabouts. But still, just in reading this, my mind immediately went to that step. So first, let's talk about what we would normally expect from a quote-unquote normal R function. So you might have a function, let's call it compute mean, whose job is to take an input, in this case, a data frame, and then compute a mean, right? And then we're going to spit back out a data frame with a new column, since we're using dplyr mutate to create a new column called mean. So if we take this arbitrary data set, the single column data set, you know, we pass it to our function, we get the output that we expect. We get a data frame with the mean, with the value of mean as a new column. So this is the case where, you know, our body is kind of immutable, right? Our data frame input will change and the results will change, but only as a function of the input that we pass to the function. But I was getting to think that actually there's maybe a more complex view of functions, perhaps when you get into the metaprogramming world, is that actually there's a way in which, and this is kind of the thing I wanted to touch on kind of briefly during my presentation. Obviously, this material that we'll dive into much, much more deeply several chapters from now. But there's a way in which you can actually take the value of one of the parameters, so the formals in a certain sense, like the values of some of the formals can actually change the body of the program. One way in which you can do it is kind of with closures. It turns out that my two examples do the exact same thing with very slightly different mechanisms. So let's imagine that you've got the same, this function compute stat quos, so for short for closure. And it'll take two arguments. So one is the data frame, just as before, and then we'll have some argument that's called fun. But it's not a function per se, but instead it's a character string that happens to contain a function, right? And so what you can do is basically within the function, you kind of capture that character string, convert it from a string. Sorry, I guess autocorrect went wrong here. Convert the character string to a quotient. So this becomes a quotient. And then you kind of pass it to this function as sort of an instruction about what to do. So in this way, I can, previously recall I'd kind of hard coded with this base thing. I'd hard coded. Oops, sorry, I skipped the section. Well, let me continue with this example, and I'll work backwards. Sorry about that. Basically, you're taking the character string median x, right? And then you're passing it into the function. So this is a character string, but what ends up happening is your function ends up becoming not so much a formula as maybe like a composable blueprint, where you're saying there's a part in your function whose instruction set can change as a function of something you pass to it from the outside of the function. So here I'm saying, use the function median in lieu of, use the function median. Previously, I'd hard coded in the function to compute the mean. Here, I'm kind of dynamically, in a certain sense, like passing a function to the function, but by way of a string. So then the result that we get is the, whoops, sorry, I think that's, something's happened here. Anyway, but what should happen is I should get. I should be getting this rate here, where I'm computing the median. You can kind of do the same thing with expressions, where imagine we have the same. Basically, all of the setup is kind of the same. You have some function where you have two arguments. One is a data frame, and the second argument is a character string that happens to contain kind of a function. And here, within the function, we're basically capturing those characters, converting them from characters to an expression, and then within this function inside of our function, translating that expression to like an evaluated expression. So here again, I can have this syntax compute stat expression, and then have these two arguments. Data frame vals and the function's median, and then I end up getting a data set where, as before, I've got my original column X and then a new column called stat that contains the median, right? I could have first quartile. I could have any arbitrary statistics that would appear within that. Anyway, I just kind of wanted to share this with everyone as a sort of an interesting thing that maybe sort of like challenges. Or maybe adds a little bit of a nuance to some of the definitions we saw within chapter 6, where it wasn't stated explicitly, but it seemed like the body was sort of like this immutable formula in all of the cases that we saw. And the only way the body never changed, but the results that were produced by the function could change, but only as a function of the inputs provided to it. Here's a case where you can actually provide an input to a function that changes the way in which the function operates, specifically like the statistic that is computed for a data frame that it takes as an input. That's pretty much all I had to share. I don't know if there are any questions or if I've just generated a lot of confusion.
Yeah. So what I have a question about the last function that you just shown. The stat. The name of the variable, the new variable, so it's from what function so and the parse expression function, what does exactly?
So basically it parses a string into an expression. So that's kind of what it does. It takes a string, so this string median x, and then parses it as an expression. So the expression is not evaluated, but then only later when I have this eval tidy is the expression evaluated.
Okay.
So in a certain sense, it's like the series of steps are one. First step is you or I as a user would write an expression as a string, or we would kind of write an instruction as a string. Within the function will take the string character, translate it into an expression. So, but an unevaluated expression. And then in this next step, it'll actually the function will actually evaluate that expression within the context of this function, the dplyr mutate function.
We use these things within a shiny app. Is that right? Yeah. Okay.
I mean, you certainly could. That was a little bit my motivation for going. I've used this in the past, and it's not so much for a shiny function, but I guess R markdown reports, where I think a lot of times, maybe there are different ways you can do this, but you know, a lot of the inputs that you get from like a shiny app or from kind of a markdown report end up being strings, and sometimes you want to pass them to functions. You know, most functions kind of expect non-string inputs, and so you need to have some kind of conversion between string inputs that I guess commonly come from shiny to like the expectations of the function. So in a sense, like this is almost, you could think about it as maybe like operating as a wrapper function that takes an instruction that's a string and then converts it through a series of steps into an expression that can be evaluated in a certain context. Like, for example, if you have a selector in Shiny, it'll select the variables you want, then you have a list of variables that are your grouping variables for, you know, and you want to compute a stat within that group, for example. Yeah, the one I didn't show, and I can share afterwards, I skipped past thinking it was a duplicate, is there's a way to do this in base R as well. So this is kind of the little secret here, is you parse the input as text, and then you use the eval function within base R. Does the same thing. I don't know if there are any other questions, or maybe I can pass the baton to Trevin.
Yeah, I can help share some things while we still have time. Ryan, do you mind sharing that one picture you had? I'm
sure sorry. I missed, no, that's okay. Yeah, let me jump back in here. Let's do desktop 2. I'll move our Slack channel over so that it doesn't turn into a... There we go. Let me know if you've got that up.
Yeah, now it is. What was that middle circle with all the dots?
Oh, are you talking about the attributes down here?
Yeah, like dot. I think so. Dot generic.
Oh, these four groups, the generic, yeah. Class, method, and group.
Yeah. What were those?
So in the dispatching mindset, these are your, I'm trying to read this text about class methods with Arthur's statement of how you can do that between dplyr as a package and base R as a package or as a service. And what my question was, is it S3 or S4? The logic of how this is interpreted, and if I can find the link that I'm reading, because it may give more context of why this is imperative. When R evaluates a function, it looks at both the object name from that lexical concept and its class type as it is manipulated in the function. And if it can't match that, then it will go up a level, higher order precedence, jump to a different higher order package and see if there's an association to it there. These four groupings are where that thought process comes in. And I'm trying to find the exact web page so that I can show you. It was an R language PDF that I'm reviewing. Let's see if I can find it here real quick. And I'm sorry for jumping around here, Trevin. I want to give you an exact answer, dot group. Okay, so I'm just going to read verbatim. We're all going to be able to see this on the screen too. Rather than having a fully fledged object oriented system, R has a class system and mechanism for dispatching based on the class of an object. The dispatch mechanism for interpreted code relies on four special objects that are stored in the evaluation frame. Now you don't get the evaluation frame. So I'm taking this thought process of the term evaluation frame as being the actual flops of the CPU. We're passing in this, it's manipulating it with based on the instructions we're giving it within the function and then giving us back out an object. We don't access that flop. We can't see anything that's happening there, but there is processing occurring. In the evaluation, these special objects are generic, class, method, and group. There are separate dispatch mechanisms used for internal functions and types that will be discussed elsewhere. So I'll drop this particular URL in. I found this informative. I ironically discovered Colin Fay had somehow has this same PDF only in markdown form or in HTML accessible. So it's verbatim the same. This PDF is almost like release notes for a version of R. It's kind of like the here's how R operates kind of document. Not that, sorry, get out of that chat window, paste that in. And why I'm bringing this to point is if you look at the title page of this document, scroll to the top, control home. This is for version 4.2.1, released on June 23rd of 2022. Being that it's in draft form implies that it's probably staging for the next release and is not technically official yet. But if based on the name or the versioning control mechanism, software versioning control, I would assume that this is currently in a draft form because it hasn't been formally released to the public yet. It is being prepared for that release and that will become official, meaning that if we go back and look for this same release notes, there's probably thousands of, well, I'll say hundreds of them based on the various versions. Anyway, go back to the image for you, Trevin. There we go. Does that help answer your question?
Yeah, that's helpful, and that link should be useful as well.
I'm going to do my best to post, and again, this is just me spitballing, garbage collecting my brain in a space where I can kind of work and manipulate it. So I'll post this to our advanced R, whether it's accepted or not. Frederick, I'll let you be the decider of that. Trevin, do you want me to stay here for anything further, or do you want me to stop
sharing? You can stop sharing. Okay. Thanks.
You bet.
Yeah, I wasn't able to prepare too much, but maybe I can share, and what I do have might be helpful. So I'm going to go ahead and drop a link in the chat. I work for a public homeless service agency. And so all of our code is on GitHub, at least most of it is. And so this is a link to one of our GitHub packages where we basically use this to download homeless management information system or HMIS data. And right now I have to do this every day. It's a daily update. And hopefully in the near future, I can get this automated. Maybe I can share my screen as well. Yeah, so this was mostly written by the prior analyst in my role, and I've been updating it and maintaining it since I've started in the role a few months ago. But yeah, I think this is the one that I wanted just to take a look at. And this is the main part of the code is our daily update. So I'm learning a ton in this role, and this was one of the reasons why I joined Advanced R Group and picked up Mastering Shiny and Colin Fay's Shiny book, was to really ramp up my R skills. So we're loading all the necessary packages for RM data. There's another package called Clarity Looker that incorporates like the Looker data, and we extract the daily download data. And then this is the actual function, and we can, there's a lot of, separate functions for this. So if you really want to like dive deeper into this, feel free to, but I was just wanted to highlight the meat of the daily update. So here, starting at line 213, is the main function. And I probably won't even be able to explain all of this. So if you do have questions, I may or may not be able to explain them. But here's all the functions that it goes through. Some of them were taken out, like COVID plots and this project evaluation, because we have the data where we don't want it updated anymore. And then remote and backup are automatically false, but usually when I run it, I switch those to true. So it just backs up the data. What's interesting is, and we'll get into this like for later chapters, is the environment calls. It makes sure that it's in the right environment, or if the environment's missing, it sets it. So I think that's like a really interesting concept, and part of the reason why I wanted to cover the environments chapter next week. So that's kind of the setup, and then since this takes quite a while to run, maybe like 15 minutes on my computer, but on the previous analyst computer, it maybe took like an hour or so on his, I think due to his internet. But this is basically like giving you like a progress update and then checking which functions.
Sorry. Can I just interrupt you for a second? Can sure. You scroll back up to the previous function?
Go up a little bit.
Yeah. So this function has a certain number of parameters, a quite large number of parameters. And then what does? Shows the time, the daytime. This is what the function does. So now if and else. So the set the time after you have provided all the parameters and said if up env, which is one of the parameters, is missing, then get up get up the environment. So it's a checking function, basically, or something like that, isn't it?
Yeah. Yeah, it checks to see if the environment's there, I think. And Clarity API is another package that needs to be loaded in order for this to run. I'm actually not sure about session, if that's an R thing or if that's a custom package thing.
Trevin, I think the session is your handshake to the server. So think of it as if your Shiny app, the server versus the UI itself, the session is the thread that connects those two together. So if you're missing a session, then it's going to create it for you, I believe, is what that is looking for.
Okay. Thank you.
Yeah.
So yeah, that's a checking, like a little checking system before. And this is like a progress bar that he had, the previous analyst had written. And then it goes through the functions that are listed up in the parameters. And I won't go through all of that, but it basically goes through and runs each of those functions. And then depending on whether those flags up there were set or not, it will back up the data and or send it to the necessary apps. And then afterwards, like when it's done, it will tell you how long it ran.
And I think your comment about the network itself. So what I'm seeing happening here, you open up your Shiny app. Inside the Shiny app or inside the server, it's making these API calls based on the information or the arguments you're passing to it, the list that you had shown before where you had commented out two of those line items. We don't need those from the server, so we're not requesting them anymore. The server itself is populating, downloading from HUD these information, daily information, whatever it may be, and then posting it to the Shiny app itself. So the storage mechanism or the server is connecting to another server, acquiring the information, processing it, and then making it available to the UI as it populates the UI and then makes it available. I think we're seeing the full exchange occur here with the topic of being this chapter six functions, but kind of the relationship of what R is doing to outside services.
Yeah. Okay, guys. Sorry about interrupt you, but we have reached the top of the hour. Really sorry about that. I think we can take another session about functions, if you like. There was Priyanka as well that would love to share some of her functions. So I'm not sure if there would be a cause of any problems within the rest of the book club's chapters. So we get in touch on Slack about next week. If we can do a third session on function, that would be great. Okay. And Trevin, you may want to start back and take back the session with all your questions and all your things and sharing whether you want, and then Priyanka will follow you if plans are this way. Okay?
Okay.
Thank you very much. Have a good night, good day, good afternoon, and see you next week. Okay. Bye now.
Thanks, everyone. Bye-bye.